Last hour, we looked how to make different kinds of electrical frequency domain filters, and the most demanding component in radio communication are bandpass filters. Also demanding components are bandpass filters in optical communications for optical frequencies, but we do not have the time to look at them into detail in this lecture. So talking about bandpass filters of narrow bandwidth, what we can actually make for an arbitrary narrow bandwidth is this circuit here, this element of the T element of a ladder filter here with one parallel tuned circuit and only series capacitors. Because for narrow bandwidths we can always make small coupling capacitors here, and we can also we can get arbitrarily narrower pass bands. We are only limited with the available Q unloaded of this circuit, because the Q unloaded of this circuit is going to increase our insertion loss we have here, the insertion loss we had here. So of course we can should not go with the Q loaded way too close to the Q unloaded, because the insertion loss of this circuit increases. While there's a difference, so this simple series equivalent here was not perfectly matched to our impedance, while this circuit here we can, at least at a single frequency, we can obtain perfect impedance matching. So this is a perfect solution. Now filters with lumped inductors, concentrated lumped inductors and lumped capacitors are frequently built in this way, with parallel tuned circuits in the parallel branches and with series capacitors, series coupling capacitors in between these tuned circuits. So this is a typical application, and it works in the limits set by the unloaded Q of these tuned circuits. But talking about cavities, there's lots of mechanical work. So this cavity here is a perfect solution. But it's lots of mechanical work to build just a single cavity. These cavities can be concatenated into more complicated filters. For instance, this cavity here was actually used. Three such cavities were connected in series to make a bandpass filter with lots of mechanical work, lots of expensive milling and turning before getting this filter here. So now the question is how to make how to make simpler bandpass filters using the same idea but combining many such cavities in just one single unit. And what we can do is not just to resort to capacitive coupling, but we may also have inductive coupling between inductors of nearby resonators. And this is quite simple to make practically. So practically looking at this, we may have our quarter wave resonators arranged inside a rectangular box. So this is the top view of this box here, and this is the top view of this box here. So it's a rectangular box, a rectangular metal box with quarter wavelength resonators at a certain spacing, and with both input and output through suitable coupling circuits. So here we may think about a capacitive coupling between these two resonators, and also here between we have 2C1 here. Say if I talk about this 2C1 we have here. So this is larger, actually a larger capacitor, and the smaller capacitor 2C1 corrected in series is just C1 between these two resonators here, and also 2C1 here, 2C1 here. So here we have four resonators in series plus capacitive coupling at the input and the output. So four such circuits connected in series. This is not all. We have between such tuned circuits, we also have inductive coupling between two adjacent resonators, and we even have inductive capacitive coupling between non-adjacent resonators. But although this non-adjacent resonator, the coupling between non-adjacent resonators is very, very small, if this thing is properly designed. Now, what should be the range of the resonators? So this is called an interdigital resonator. See, if we put our fingers, one from one side, the other from the other side, still one from the other side, the other from the other side, all our resonators from one side, and this is called a comp filter. These are typical expressions used in the industry. Interdigital filter and comp filter. Interdigital arrangement of resonators, comp arrangement of resonators. What is the difference between the two? In the case of the interdigital filter, the coupling between two neighbor resonators actually sums up. You see the red dots here are marking the polarity of our windings of our coils. Since the polarities here are inverted, we have a 180 degrees shift in the magnetic coupling and 0 degrees shift in the capacitive coupling. But the capacitive coupling advances by 1/4 period, and the inductive coupling is delayed by 1/4 period. So in altogether, here the magnetic coupling actually sums with the capacitive coupling. This is not really a correct mathematical expression, but just to tell you that we have summation of the couplings between two resonators. The inductive coupling is summing to the capacitive coupling. While in the case of the comp filter, the inductive coupling, since all inductors are in the same directions, the inductive coupling has the same phase as the capacitive coupling, but since the capacitive coupling is ahead 90 degrees and the inductive coupling lags by 90 degrees, they actually subtract. So we have coupling subtraction here. So what is now the end story of this filter? Is in the case of an interdigital filter, we have a stronger coupling. So stronger coupling is useful for broader filters. For narrower filters or smaller filters, we use the comp configuration to have less coupling between two adjacent resonators. So we, by choosing the suitable design technology, we can make the best of our available, say, metal enclosure, putting things together. The interdigital filter is somewhat better because actually the coupling between two non-adjacent resonators actually subtracts, because two non-adjacent resonators are in comp configuration, while this is summing. So we can have a better shaped passband with an interdigital filter. We have spurious effects a little bit larger in the comp filter. But the comp filter for the same passband, if we are talking for the same passband, the comp filter actually works with a smaller spacing. A smaller spacing means a smaller filter, means a less expensive filter. These are SMA connectors here, and these are just the insulator in the central conductor being coupled to the actual resonator of the filter. So we can use both arrangements depending on our requirements. And the interdigital filter has a better shaped passband, while the comp filter has smaller physical dimensions. Also, the interdigital filter is easier to calculate. We can neglect end effects with the comp filter, while we cannot neglect end effects with the interdigital filter. We can neglect the end effects that not have much influence on the filter shape, while in the comp filter the end effects have a very high influence on the filter shape, because the two couplings subtract, and this difference here is actually a function of the end effect on the resonator. So a comp filter is more difficult to calculate, at least approximately to calculate. Or also doing 3D electromagnetic simulation, it's also more demanding, the comp filter, than the interdigital filter. But we do have both solutions available in order to build our filters. Let's see how such filters are being made. So this here is actually a comp filter. It's a comp duplexer for 3.4 GHz. In fact, 3.4 and 3.5. 3.5 is receiving, 3.4 is transmitting or vice versa, 3.4 receiving, 3.4 transmitting. We have the two connectors for 3.4 and 3.5 gigahertz here, and we have the common connection here. So each of these filters has 8 quarter wavelength resonators. See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 resonators. And these resonators have at one side they have a tap coupling here, a tap coupling on the resonator, and at the other side they have inductive coupling. So this was a choice of the designer of this filter. All these filters are coupled through cutouts, see, in the shielding enclosure here. So this is actually a cover that covers all this, that makes this a solid block out of this filter. So the bottom is actually milled out of a thick plate of aluminum, and the top cover is a much thinner plate still made of aluminum. Aluminum is a good electrical conductor. It is further silver plated to have the best possible conductivity of the first surface, to have the best possible unloaded Q, so minimum insertion loss we are looking here for, minimum insertion loss. Each of these cavities has an individual tuning screws, and these are these brass tuning screws, the thick tuning screws here that come on top of these cavities, and with these brass screws we actually tune the central frequency of each resonator independently. Further, we have this thinner inox screws here. These screws here, these inox screws, are actually used to adjust the coupling. So these slots here are filled with these tiny screws here, and the smaller screws are actually used to adjust the coupling between each of these two cavities. So we can make a narrower filter or a broad filter by just adjusting these screws here. So this filter has really all components tunable. If I go back to the schematic here, both C1 are tunable and C2 are tunable. We also have some inductive coupling here because this is a comp filter. All resonators are in the same direction, and the two couplings subtract actually, and that subtraction can be quite pretty well regulated with this coupling screws here, adjusting the coupling between two resonators. This was a duplexer, so to fit both the receiver at 3.4 GHz and the transmitter at 3.5 GHz of a WiMAX base station up to a single antenna here. This was its practical application. WiMAX is no longer being used, so these filters are now obsolete. But filters for other frequency ranges are done in a similar fashion. So this is about comp filter design. There's yet another solution, and this solution here is actually not a real comp filter. All resonators are put in the same direction, but each of these resonators is located inside a square aluminum tube. So this square aluminum tube actually shields each resonator from the neighboring resonators. So we do not have, we have shields in between. We have here a shield, we have here a shield, we have here a shield. And on the cold end of this resonator, on the minimum of the electric field, we have magnetic coupling. We have input magnetic coupling, output magnetic coupling, and this can be, this copper foil can be squeezed and moved to adjust the input and output coupling. And we have inductive coupling. These loops here actually make the inductive coupling between two neighboring resonators. We do not have any electric coupling because this is shielded by this aluminum tubes here. These screws actually enter this hole here, and with this capacitor here, variable capacitor, we can adjust the central frequency of each of these rods. So each resonator can be adjusted on its central frequency, but is shielded from its neighbor. It is shielded from its neighbor resonator electrically. So we only have magnetic coupling through these loops. And this loop, loops through suitable screws here can be turned, so the magnetic coupling between each two adjacent resonators can be changed by turning these screws. So in this way, again, we have adjustable central frequency with the capacitor here, but adjustable magnetic coupling between these loops here. So here we actually do not have this circuit here. We do not have capacitive coupling, but we have inductive coupling between adjacent resonators. So we have a mutual inductance between adjacent resonators and no capacitors here. So this is a little bit different design here. As I said, this is although all four resonators are directed in the same direction, they have no absolutely, they have little if any electrical coupling between two adjacent resonators. And these are the coaxial resonators for input and output. Here are N connectors, here we had SMA connectors here. Here we have N connectors for this filter here. For cavities it is not necessary to make cavities in vacuum. Actually we can fill cavities with a dielectric to make filters smaller. And what is the advantage of filling the cavity? We can fill cavities with a very good dielectric, like ceramics based on titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide, if pure titanium dioxide, has a very low tangent loss. Very low tangent loss. So it's a very low loss dielectric. Vacuum, of course, is the best dielectric, but vacuum is large. With a relative permittivity of 100, the filter can be made 10 times smaller. So the wavelength actually decreases with the square root of the relative permittivity, and the relative permittivity of 100, we can make a 10 times smaller filter. So what we have here, these filters are actually comp filters for 3.4 GHz and single individual resonators, lambda 4 resonators for 450 MHz. These are resonators for 400 MHz. They are coaxial resonators. They are shorted on this end here, shorted, and they are open on the other end here. And in fact, on this open end, we actually couple with our circuit. What is the advantage besides being smaller? Besides being 10 times smaller, we also have a 10 times shorter electrical conductor. 10 times shorter electrical conductors means much less metal loss. Here in this case it's silver plating, so it's loss inside silver, and this loss can be made 10 times smaller if the resonator is 10 times shorter. So it also improves the Q. Though the ceramic has some own dielectric loss, but the resistive loss in the inductor here is much smaller because the wire of the inductor is shorter. How do these filters look like? So these filters here are actually three element comp filters with input, output, and the three inside we have three quarter wavelength resonators that are shorted on this side here. So this side they are shorted and they're open on the other side, and we have capacitive coupling on the input and the output. So these are three element resonators of different manufacturers. They're looking a little bit different. They are shorted, say silver plated on one side, and they have no plating here on the other side, and we have capacitive coupling on the input. Then we have comp coupling between adjacent resonators, and we have again capacitive coupling at the output to make the whole filter. We can also make more complex filters. So this is actually here a seven element filter, seven resonators, but only five resonators here are used for the passband, and we can adjust the coupling by these small details on the metal plating. We have capacitive input and output coupling, and further we have two shunt resonators at the input and at the output of this filter. These shunt resonators actually cause zeros in the transfer function, and they make for sharper edges of the passband. So Still, we do not have infinite group delay here. We are have finite group delay, but the edges of the passband may be made much sharper if we add these two resonators at the input and the output, so we have a sharper edges of the passband with these two shunt resonators that actually these are band stop filters outside the passband of our filter. So this is in total a 7-element filter shown over here. So this is the solution to make filters out of ceramic bandpass filter. These were actually used in WiMAX equipment, this 3.4 GHz, and this was old NMT mobile phones. They were used in old NMT mobile phones in the 450 MHz range. So they are actually all taken outside communication equipment. We can make here these filters are fixed frequencies. This filter actually been fixed in the manufacturer, while this filter here, can be slightly tuned by adding a tuned capacitors over here. So this connection here actually needs capacitive coupling on both sides, but we can also connect a capacitor to ground here to tune, to lower its frequency. So this can also be tuned. They may be square in cross section or rectangular in cross section, doesn't really matter much. The frequencies, that's the reason the frequencies are slightly above, because of the capacitive coupling, the frequencies are slightly above. This is probably 550 MHz, this is 600 MHz, above the 450, because there's an external capacitor that's going to be added here and in any occasion. So this is the solution for modern electronic equipment to build inside filters. There is yet another kind of filter we may need, and I already mentioned it here. Here we have actually band stop resonators at the input and the output of these filters. So we may actually need band stop filters in some occasion. Why do we would ever require band stop filters? Well, the issue is shown on this first image we had here in this lecture here. In antenna duplexers, both insertion loss is critical and rejection of unwanted signals is also critical. It can be calculated that we can make a much better filter using band reject filters here, so band stop filters. And that's the main purpose of band stop filters. Well, theory is a little bit different. Okay, theory for a band stop filter, we have it here. Theory, we have a series tuned circuit in the parallel branches, and we have parallel tuned circuits in the serial branches. So we can again calculate the Z and Y elements of the ladder network. We can calculate ZK, and still we have yet another degree of freedom, because besides ZK and omega 01, omega 02, the two band limits, we still have a fourth parameter that's not defined here. So even in the case of a band stop filter, we have a similar request, design choice that's still left open. That's one choice. And the other thing we do not know is that all four inductors here may be difficult to make. All four inductors may have quite a large value, and all four inductors do not have any grounded point. They're all, especially these two inductors here have both ends lifted from system ground. So this also makes implementation difficult. So the first thing, how to get rid of the fourth variable that still have, because we have four components here, L1, C1, L2, C2. How to get rid of the fourth variable? It's to make a sensible choice for the band stop filter. Also here to have these two tuned circuits resonate at the same frequency as the series tuned circuit. And this defines the fourth variable, or in other words, keeping the ratio of inductors and capacitors the same. And this is designed as M here. M may be any number here, any ratio. What is the characteristic impedance of this filter? It's real at low frequency, it is real at high frequencies, and it's purely imaginary in the band stop frequency range. in the stop band frequency range. Here it's purely imaginary, the frequency, for, of course, for ideal lossless inductors and capacitors here. Also, the formula for ZK simplifies, and the formula for the two, both frequencies, both limits of the stop band also simplifies here. But still we have the problems how to implement these inductors here. This is still a problem. This problem is left open, and it's quite it's more difficult to solve in the band stop filter. Let's see at the practical solutions. How can we do these things with band stop filters? With band stop filters, actually, we make a band stop filter with transmission lines. For higher frequencies, it makes sense to use transmission lines. Quarter wavelength transmission lines are available. They have, and we have open transmission lines to make open transmission lines. This is actually a pi equivalent, not a T equivalent of this one here. We have open transmission lines to replace the series tuned circuits, and we have an impedance inverter with this this transmission line here. So we do not have an equivalent for the parallel tuned circuit. This is difficult to make. We don't have this one here. So we resort to a similar solution like here with impedance inverters, but for stop band, not for pass band. And here we have them for stop band, and we have this band stops in this open transmission lines here. Well, this is just an impedance inverters here. This idea works. It works with coaxial lines. But with coaxial lines, as with any other line, we immediately end up in the problem of making high impedance coaxial lines. The impedance of the characteristic impedance of a coaxial line is approximately, here are physical constant in between 60 ohms divided by the square root of a permittivity, and then that's a logarithm. But making coaxial line with a characteristic impedance over 150 ohms is terrible, because we need a very large ratio of R shield divided by R central. So very thin central conductor, and this can usually not be made with coaxial line. So we are limited here perhaps to 150, maybe 200 ohms. Practical value is 100 ohms, the maximum impedance of a coaxial line. Also, for other transmission lines, we cannot make very high characteristic impedances. So what is the workaround now here, because we cannot make these two filters? The workaround is to use parallel tuned circuits or even cavities here, and have some kind of magnetic coupling to have a band reject filter here. Have another band reject cell here, and have an impedance inverter in between. This is the solution for band stop filters, and this is in fact being used in many commercial filters, like we have on the following examples. I have many pictures in this lecture just to give you an impression of how these things works, how these things looks like in practice. So this is actually practically made. The next picture, we have a duplexer for a GSM base station. This is a very common component right now. And with GSM, we have 35 megahertz frequency spacing between transmit and receive frequency. For the base station, receive frequency is lower, is 928 megahertz, and 952 megahertz is actually the transmit frequency of the base station. This is just 35 megahertz around 950 megahertz. So this is very close. We need high Q resonators, and here actually we have four high Q coaxial resonators that can be tuned with these tuning screws up here. They can be tuned exactly on frequencies, these four resonators. Maybe it's the other way, when the four screws come from this direction, and the these tunes, there should be four tuned screws up here. There are five, but this is not the correct picture. Looking from the other side to our filter, we have coupling here, and you see that we have two different arrangements of coupling. Here we have actually a coupling loop, while here we are coupling to a tap we attach on the quarter wavelength resonators. So this coupling has different performance of this coupling. These filters are actually pass band at one frequency and stop band at the other frequency. So it's a combination of both. And this combination is actually done by these different coupling arrangements for the two frequencies, for the above frequency and for the below frequency. You can see better this arrangement here. And there are quarter wavelength lines in between here. So this is a quarter wavelength inside Teflon, of course, because this is inside Teflon, is shorter than free space. And here is also quarter wavelength line. This is also quarter wavelength line. This is also quarter wavelength line between two adjacent resonators. So this is actually one half of this filter. This section here is actually identical to what we have here. This is its equivalent circuit. We have a magnetic coupling from this loops, two tuned cavities, and the quarter wavelength section in between here, and this is the same quarter wavelength section. For the other half of the filter, the arrangement of the coupling is different. It's no longer simple magnetic. It's a coupling with a tap on the resonator, so they have a pass band on the other side of the stop band for these two here to have the best possible performance of these filters. And this filter is actually the best we can do with the least amount of money. We just have a extruded part of aluminum here, manufactured in volume. This is all volume, high volume manufacturers, because GSM base stations are now a high volume product here. And this is actually a very good filter. So here really the performance is optimized to the maximum, to have maximum performance for the minimum amount of hardware here with such a filter. On some occasions, the engineer has to design such a filter. And this is an example of a filter we had to make for a broadband transmitter installed on a drone. You know that the drone, this was actually a fixed-wing drone, a high-performance drone aircraft, that was actually had installed a jamming transmitter, and the jamming transmitter operating over a wide frequency band. But this jamming transmitter made us a problem. This jamming transmitter was interfering with the GPS receiver on the same drone, that was required for the navigation of the drone itself. So we should not disturb with our transmitter, we should not work a broadband jamming transmitter for a military drone, we should not disturb the GPS receiver it was used for navigation. So we had to build a band stop filter that removed the GPS frequency band out of the spectrum of this broadband jamming transmitter. And this was the filter we actually built. This filter is actually exactly the same as this thing here. We have a lambda quarter wavelength line here, impedance impedance inverter, and we have two open lines, and all the circuit is made as a microstrip circuit. So this is actually a printed circuit board laminate. It's all copper on the other side, and this line is actually a line against the ground plane on the other side, and everything is housed in the small brass box to be installed on the drone, SMA input and output connectors. And this filter actually worked very well. We were able to eliminate completely the interference of our jamming transmitter to the onboard GPS receiver on the same drone. And you know that on a drone aircraft, usually you have little space available, so you cannot play with the spacing of the two antennas. This was yet built in another technology. This was microstrip technology, because it's easily to reproduce and it's not a particularly good laminate. It's only FR4. So glass fiber epoxy does not have a very good radio frequency performance. So this is actually this filter actually made in microstrip technology on FR4 is here for a band stop band reject filter for GPS, so that we did not, with our transmitter, we did not disturb our own GPS receiver on the same drone. This was the question. This is a wideband response of this filter starting from 500 MHz to 280 MHz. The drone was actually designed to jam mobile phones and to interfere with mobile phones. So here in the GPS band, we are well away from mobile phones band. So this insertion loss of this filter around the GSM band is actually not disturbing the operation of the jamming transmitter in the mobile phone bands here, over here. Okay, talking about this cheap solution using cheap printed circuit board construction, let's see what we can do with printed circuit boards. On printed circuit boards, on a double-sided printed circuit board, we can build microstrip lines. So here is a microstrip line. The generator is connected between the ground plane on one side and the microstrip line on the other side. With microstrip lines, we can get mostly impedances that are useful. Microstrip lines can go close to 50 ohm characteristic impedance. They may, on the upper end, may go up to, say, 150 ohms, like here. On the lower end, we are not limited. We are just limited with the width of the microstrip for the low frequency end. For the low frequency end of such a microstrip line. We can use different substrate. The cheap substrate is glass fiber epoxy, FR4. It has a permittivity of about 0.43, but it has a poor tangent delta. It has a poor tangent delta of just 0.02. This means capacitive loss of Q50, but we should also consider the huge resistive loss here, because this microstrip line is actually attached to the glass fiber epoxy through black copper. This is a specially etched copper. It's called black copper in printed circuit board technology. That's very rough. It attaches very well to epoxy substrates, but has a problem of high radio frequency loss. On the other hand, we can use Teflon substrates or even other hydrocarbon substrates that have a somewhat smaller dielectric constant, but have a very low tangent delta, so we can obtain very high Q unloaded on Teflon boards. Teflon is, of course, more expensive, but what is most important, Teflon is very difficult to manufacture because plating holes in Teflon is quite difficult. Nothing attaches to Teflon. We can make quarter wavelength resonators in microstrip technology. We can make half wave resonators in microstrip technology. With quarter wavelength resonators, we can make both interdigital filters and comp filters with the known advantages of one and another. Since we usually require a strong coupling in microstrip filters because of the low Q unloaded, usually we use interdigital filters on a microstrip printed circuit board. The problem is here that we have higher order resonances with quarter wavelength resonators already at 3 times the fundamental frequency of such a filter. So in order to use this filter in a broader frequency range, we'll probably need to combine these filters with other filters, with low pass filters, to avoid these higher overtone responses of this filter. With comp filters, as I said, they also have the quarter wavelength resonators has another resonance at 3 times its fundamental frequency. So to avoid this, we have to be careful about these overtones. And both interdigital and comp filters require vias to the ground, via holes, metal plated via holes to the ground, to have this resonator grounded at one side. These via holes, as I said, they are very difficult to plate in Teflon. Another solution is to have half-wave resonators. Half-wave resonators can be arranged sidewise in this way, so that the magnetic and capacitive coupling actually sum here. So we have strong coupling between two resonators. We may have some special structure for initial wave launching and recovery of the electrical signal at the end of the resonator, so somewhat higher characteristic impedance here. So we may make bandpass filters also with half-wave resonators, and there's an advantage here. We have no critical via holes here. So there are no via holes here. But the disadvantage, there are two disadvantages. This structure is very large, now is lambda half long. Lambda half on the microstrip board, considering also the permittivity. And the next higher order resonance is just, the next overtone is just at twice the fundamental frequency. So the next overtone is closer for such a bandpass filter. Since this structure is very large, one solution is to bend or fold resonators. So to fold half-wave resonators in this fashion. And in this fashion, so half-wave is from here up to here. So this distance here is at maximum quarter wavelength. And we can pack them much closer together. So to get a compact filter design, we may do this way. We do it this way with half-wave resonators. And also the coupling structure, we just may select the correct tab here to have the correct outside characteristic impedance of this filter. So this is also a viable solution for compact filters for lower frequency. While for higher frequencies, maybe we can go just with straight lambda half resonators. It's not a problem to design such thing. So this is frequently used in lots of equipment. This kind of filters are frequently used. And let's see now a few examples how these filters are used in different equipment. So here we have an example of simple interdigital filters. So this is an interdigital filter with two resonators, one resonator, second resonator, input coupling and output coupling. All built in microstrip technology. This is an FR4 board. On there is a ground plane on the other side. You see that some components need to be connected on the ground plane, like these things through holes, and there are no, this, since these via holes are not plated, I inserted here a piece of wire here, copper wire. This is another similar bandpass filter, and there is an amplifier stage in between. And of course, this distance here is kept large enough not to have feedback from the output amplifier back to the input of the amplifier. And this is actually a 25 dB amplifier, so quite lots of gain here. This is a bandpass filter for twice the bandpass filter, 1.2 GHz. These filters are very broad here. They have somewhere around 200 MHz bandwidth because the Q unload is quite low, so in order not to have too much insertion noise, also the Q loaded has to be kept low. So Q loaded less than 10 for a Q unloaded above about 30 here, and having about 3 dB of insertion loss for each filter. There is yet another example here, built on the same laminate, same size of the external box, metal box here, having bandpass filter for 2.3 GHz. They are much smaller, they are the same design, but much shorter than those for 1.2 GHz. The same design. Also same kind of amplifier here. Here we have also a bandpass filter at half the frequency because these harmonic mixers with this diode here require the local oscillator at half the frequency. And we also have a band stop frequency in here. This band stop filter is actually one open line, then quarter wavelength line, and again one quarter line, a band stop filter for 1.15 GHz is also here. So also the band stop that we had here is also made here, a similar band stop here. What should we take care about microstrip circuits? You see here we have a metal box. Also here we have a metal box. This metal box may act as a cavity resonator. If we go to one of the first pictures today, we may get a rectangular cavity that may have its own resonators. So this metal box can actually cause couplings between different parts of the circuits here if we hit the resonance of this box. So where is the trick here? The trick here is to have these boxes made quite long and quite shallow. Long and shallow, so means quite narrow and shallow. So as long as if we keep this dimension be below half of a wavelength, we are sure that all the resonances will be far above the operating frequency of our circuit. That's the trick. Making the box of the correct shape to shift all the resonances beyond beyond our operating frequencies. Further, if we shift this, if this does not help enough, if we still have effect on these resonances on higher frequencies, then we can also put microwave absorber foam inside these boxes, and this is actually the solution being used in television receivers for 12 GHz, satellite TV receivers at 12 GHz. This is a solution to use there. Okay? So, these were all quarter wavelength resonator filters. We can also look at half wave resonator filters. This was actually a development board to get the best possible response, trying different filters here. You see that some filters could be made straightforward, while other filters on other substrates required some impedance matching circuit here. On glass fiber epoxy and on ceramic filled Teflon of course has much lower insertion loss, but this was actually not a problem in this application because these filters are very broad. This is a bandpass filter for an 8 to 12 GHz bandpass. Since this bandpass is so broad, the Q loaded is very low. Also, the Q unloaded of conventional FR4 is good enough for this, and the final circuit was this one here. So one bandpass filter here, one bandpass filter here, amplifier transistors here. This is a transistor, this is a hemmed high electron mobility transistor, and this is also a hemmed high electron mobility transistor for 12 GHz. It's of course its common electrode, its source is grounded, gate is and drain receives the supply voltage, while this transistor is operated at zero bias on the gate. So this is actually the description of this circuit here. And this is a bandpass filter from 8 to 12 GHz. This was actually required to remove the fundamental after a frequency doubler circuit. This was the practical application of this circuit in quite a broad frequency band. It was a signal generator covering the whole frequency band, and it included the circuit, included the doubler frequency doubler. So I had to remove the fundamental frequency, having only its second harmonic available on the output. Considering the frequency here, these were straight lambda half resonators, straight lambda half. If I go to lower frequencies and I still want to use lambda half resonators, then I have to fold these resonators. I have to use bent resonators here. And this is exactly the solution I have shown here. So this solution actually is using folded resonators. And this is the circuit, here. I have many filters here. This was a transmit and receive mixer for 2.3 GHz or for 3.4 GHz. These are amplifier stages with MMICs. This is a mixer built with a single hemmed. It's a resistive mixer, built with a hemmed transistor. This is a amplifier stage with a bipolar transistor, and a frequency multiplier stage with another hemmed transistor here. So I enter here with 500 megahertz. I multiply this. I get the fourth harmonic in this hemmed transistor. I filter out the fourth harmonic with this bandpass filter, amplify, once again filter the fourth harmonic here to have good rejection of unwanted harmonics, and I have the mixer, and this is actually the image rejection mixer. The image here is around 1.5 GHz. I should reject 1.5 and let through 2.3 GHz. So this is the bandpass filter here, also made from folded resonators for a slightly higher frequency than this here. This is the same circuit, similar circuit replicated for 3.4 GHz, only that here the multiplication factor is by 6, 6 times, 6 harmonic, and I need very good filters here, so two filters connected in series, amplifier stage in between these two filters, passive resistive mixer with this hemmed transistor, to get the IF in the 500 MHz range, 3.4 GHz, the image rejection filter at the high frequency range. Also, in the case of these filters, I should keep care about the lateral dimension of this box. And actually, I have lambda half at 3.4 GHz, lambda is 9 centimeters. So half lambda is 45 millimeters. This size here is just 30 millimeters to avoid any resonances of my closed box. A cover comes on top of this box in the desired frequency range. So this is something I have to care about when building circuits in this fashion. Finally, one final detail for today. How to make filters with less ripple? We saw here that uniform filters have quite a variable characteristic impedance. This variable characteristic impedance may have good matching here, but may have high ripple here, and may cause high ripple here because of impedance mismatch. This what causes ripple in the actual passband. I have reasonable ripple in the center, but have much higher ripple at the band edges when the impedance matching is worse, and this causes reflections inside the filter structure. A filter is also a transmission line, acts as a transmission line in the passband, and I can also have reflected waves here, and reflected waves always cause ripple in the passband. How to get this of ripple? How to get rid of this ripple? How to get a nice flat passband? And the trick is shown here. Of course, losses in my circuits, like losses in microstrip boards made on FR4, this have quite a flat passband without any special arrangement, because their insertion loss is already some 3 or 4 dB for each filter, so I have already lots of loss inside the filters. So reflections are attenuated because of the loss of the filter components. But if I have a good components with low losses, then I can play on the filter design. I design a uniform central section that has a quite variable characteristic impedance. The characteristic impedance stays real in the passband, but it's changing a lot in the passband. And then I had impedance matching sections at the input and at the output. These impedance matching sections may reduce my ripple in the passband, may reduce changes if designed correctly. And this is the way to design many filters today, if you need many stages. If you need just 2 or 3 stages, this is not required really. 2 or 3 cells, 2 or 3 reactive components. But if you have many reactive components, then it's good to get rid of this ripple in the passband as much as you can. Get rid of the ripple, not just get rid of the ripple, get rid of variable group delay. So if I have group delay variations, that also distorts my signal. So group delay is also a problem, not just amplitude ripple, but also phase ripple. That's also a problem, and there are different filter designs. So here, if I go back to, there are different designs for these matching networks. If I want just a flat amplitude response, or if I want the minimum group delay, there are different filter designs to do these things. Okay, this is about filter designs. I'm not going much into detail here because it would take the whole semester just to discuss filter design. But there is something I should learn out of this when using filters. Frequently, I can obtain the desired response by concatenating two filters. That's not simple to do at all. Why? Because this filter does not have good impedance matching, and this filter also lacks good impedance matching. Even if I put together two filters with very good impedance matching network, still here things go badly wrong if I put them in series. Further, it depends on the length of the connecting line between these filters. The length of this line will change the phase of the reflection, even in the case of the impedance matching networks, and will cause high ripple. It may also cause spurious responses outside the filter passband. So this is real trouble. Never try to do this. Always try to handle your filter as a same filter. Never concatenate two filters in series. If you ever have to concatenate two filters in series, you have to put an insulating device in between the filter. It may be a circulator with a load, so this is a ferrite isolator. It may be an amplifier stage, if that does not cause problems, maybe a buffer amplifier in between here. But also, always, if you have to connect two filters in series, also think about the isolation here between two filters. with a buffer stage unidirectional amplifier, or with an isolator, that's again a unidirectional component of a right isolator inside the passband, to get the filter responses you would like to have, because this thing will not work. Filters should never be concatenated on the blind, because if you just connect two filters in series, you usually get high ripple, you even get out of band frequency response. This is a real trouble with filters. So today that's it about radio frequency filters made from lumped components like capacitor inductors, made from cavities, made from microstrip transmission lines. Microtransmission lines, you can also make resonators out of them. So this is all, I would say, conventional design. This is all really LC design, what we started with today, our lecture. This is really tuned. All these are tuned circuits with inductors and capacitors. But this thing does not always get to the desired result. Sometimes we need even higher Q than a rectangular cavity can make, or this rectangular cavity may be too large, or even the coaxial cavity is too large, and then we have to resort to mechanically smaller devices like mechanical shear resonators. Shear because the shear wave does not couple into air or into liquids surrounding these resonators. And these mechanical resonators will be covered in the next lecture. So next lecture we should talk about mechanical resonators. How do we make them? Where do we use them? What are the purposes? What is the purpose of these mechanical resonators? And there are many, many different possibilities to make both single resonators and filters out of mechanical resonators. We may have mechanical couplings between different stages. We may have electrical coupling between different stages. And we are going to talk about this third very important application of silicon. As I said, silicon is important to make transistors. Silicon is important to make optical fibers. But nevertheless, silicon is equally important. The third application of silicon is make to quartz crystals to make high Q mechanical resonators, piezoelectric mechanical resonators for our circuits, for our communication equipment. And we shall talk about these resonators in our next lecture.